Welcome everyone. This is Reyha Çolak, a senior lecturer at Columbia University and a member of the RISPEC Graduate School family. I'm very excited and grateful to be here today in our fifth lecture of the Risale Academy Colloquium. We have a wonderful scholar from the UK this time, Dr. Ömer Kuru, and he will talk about today on the concept of self, nefs, in Arabic. This is a very important topic which relates to our existential questions. Before I go deeper into describing the topic, I would like to introduce our speaker today. And before even that, I want to give you a brief overview of our Risale Colloquium. This is the fifth event in the Risale Colloquium series, and we invite scholars of the Quran through the lens of the Risale collection, which is titled Epistles of Light and written by Said Nursi, a 20th century scholar from Turkey and renewer of faith, to share their knowledge. Our scholars will share their knowledge and facilitate critical readings, interactions, engagement, and discussions on Risale around thematically organized topics. And our audience could be anyone who wants to deepen a critical understanding of faith. So if you have been following us, this is great. If you haven't been following our channel, please make sure you follow us and make sure you turn on your alerts so you can be updated about our next program. So far, we have talked about a critique of modernity with Dr. Adnan Aslan in our first discussion, and a discussion on atheism and theism with Dr. Hakan Gök. In our third lecture, we had Dr. Zeki Sarıtoprak on the topic of death and beyond. And then we had holistic healing through Quran with Dr. Salih Yücel. Today we have Dr. Ömer Kuru from the UK on the problem of the self according to Quran through the lens of the Risale-i Nur collection. Bediüzzaman Said Nursi defined self as a mirror to the manifestation of divine oneness. Owing to its function as a mirror, Nursi places the self at the center of man's or woman's constant struggle to achieve a true understanding of God and the universe. If self, we translated as nefs, is employed by all the other internal faculties, and especially by ene, which means I, self, or ego in Arabic, as a mirror to reflect the names and attributes of God in the way defined by the Quran and the prophetic tradition, then man can rise up to the level of certainty in his or her belief. There are important key concepts in the writing of Nursi: other indicative meaning, manaya harfi, and self-referential meaning, manaya ismi, to understand the Quran through the lens of his collection of epitomes of light. In other words, Risale-i Nur. Today, our speaker, Dr. Ömer Kuru, will enlighten us about this concept, the concept of self. I want to introduce our speaker today. Dr. Ömer Kuru was born in Gaziantep in Turkey. He has been working on Said Nursi's collection called Risale-i Nur for more than 30 years. Dr. Ömer Kuru completed his bachelor degree at the University of Istanbul in 2000. His readings from Epistles of Light, Risale-i Nur, started out of his curiosity at an early age, and later has accelerated with a PhD titled The Self in Relation to the Concept of God in Durham University in the UK in 2013. He has worked in various universities, and he currently works as an academic member of theology department at the University of Aberdeen, and works on contemporary Sufism, the relation between self and ego from Nursian perspective, as his postdoctoral research. Dr. Kuru is also interested in methods of science. He thinks that the Nursian approach to methods of science is unique in that it provides that there is a compatibility between positive science and religion. He has written one book and a number of articles. And I'm very grateful that he made time out of his busy schedule to be with us today. And I would like to give the mic to Dr. Ömer Kuru. And in the meantime, please, if you have any questions, you can put your questions in our comment box of YouTube channel. We would be happy to refer to your questions by the end of our lecture. Dr. Ömer Kuru, the stage is yours, please.
Hello, everyone. Dr. Çolak, thank you very much for having me tonight. Hopefully that will be a good session about the concept of self, nafs in Arabic. So this is such an important subject because this is a key concept to understand the Quran. And I will display or some slides. So in detail, as much as we can, I know the time is limited, about 40, 45 minutes, then Q&A session there will be. So I will give some numbers about the concept of self in Quran, nafs in Quran. But at least now, I would like to emphasize the point. There are so many nafs verses in the Quran, about 300 verses. If you think about the Quran is consisted of more than 6,000 verses, it means, one of 20 verses is about the concept of nafs, self. And there are different meanings, and before and after Quran, nafs has gained some other new meanings. So this is a key concept. If you know, if you miss the point, the concept of self, nafs, then you can miss the message of the Quran. So we need to understand this key concept. That's why hopefully that will be a helpful session for the audience.
Dr. Ömer Kuru, I would like to mention briefly, first, I'm very, very sorry. Yonara was here with us, and as you all see her, she is a very demanding seeker of knowledge and a great hardworking student. And hopefully, this topic, she will listen to this the first time, and she may have some questions at the end, which will be a great way to figure out if we could make our point. And the secondly, Dr. Ömer Kuru, could you please tell us a little bit first why you started with nafs? Because when we talk about the concept of self, everybody hears about the ego. But you prefer to put self instead of the nafs instead of ego.
That's right. And first of all, I appreciate Yonara. She is my field, so I can thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Why I focus on self? Actually, at the very beginning of my study. In 2006, when I started PhD, I promised myself not to use any synonym because, if you use synonym, then there would be, you can miss the point. This is a PhD. I said, okay, I'll keep them separate. And when I'm sure 100%, then I will say, okay, this can be matched with this and vice versa. To be honest, my PhD subject is about self, but the very central or primary concept was ana, ego. But again, the same thing applicable here. We cannot say ana equal ego because, again, the same mistake. ego is, you know, formulated by Freud, and I benefited a lot from his books. I have read his books and articles several times. But at the end, Freud was focused on the materialistic aspect of ego. So there was no space for belief or divine concept in his studies. So that's why we have to be very careful. Then after a while, maybe 1 year or slightly more than 1 year, then I realized I can say that nafs and self is the same thing. But of course, you know, there is no only one self. There are compartments. So we need to know in detail the compartments and how it works, how they work and related with each other. But about ego, definitely we can't say ego equal ene. No. After a while, after some slides, when we about the eighth or the ninth one, when we come to the concept of we mentioned slightly about the method of science, and Nursi contributed to the method of science as well, which is very, very important. And he talks about materialistic aspect and the Quranic aspect. But as you said in your summary, they are in comparable. There's a connection between them because, you know, always it's being presented like this is religion and this is science. Be careful, you know, this is such a presentation. We don't have to believe because of, you know, it's just being presented to us like this. No, this is religion and this is science. As you see, they are separate and there is an incompatibility between them. No, this is not right. This is just, you know, if you talk about the materialistic aspect of the universe, then if you claim there is no space for the, you know, religion, so in that case you can make this presentation. But Nursi sort out this problem, and he presents in another way, another schematic, and we see how they are compatible and works perfectly. We will see in the presentation, hopefully. Even though my we can talk about ego as well. And shall we start if you like? Okay, yes. The screen. Sometimes and now, just the first one, and is attached to his self. It sounds very mystic. That would be nice, very briefly, if we summarize what it means. Ana is one of the tools in his in mankind's self. So I will explain the self, but at least, you know, Ana is one of the tools. So we should understand how it works, how the key and his to this concept of self. The self is a key concept to understand divine concept. This is the second important question. What is, who am I? The first question is, of course, you know, who is God? He who knows his own self knows is a mirror. And the very famous metaphor is, you know, our self is a mirror to the divine quality. The qualities, we have the same qualities with God. No. Just like the mirror metaphor, you know, there is a sun, because this is just a reflection. So our qualities, and hopefully in the following part of the presentation we will talk about, just indicators to the divine quality. Nafs is key concept, because there are several meaning of, we should know what it means. If we miss the point, we can easily see the Muslim scholars who this considers himself, it's difficult to make a distinction. So the same person can be considered as a theologian and also a philosopher. But in Islamic Islamic literature, we can clearly see
messages that they are saying that they can only hearing you parts of your sentences, and the technical our technical office tells us that maybe it would be better if you don't share, because the data that we receive from you is cut off when you share the screen. This happened after you shared the screen. So would you want me to share the maybe if I can share it from here, they would hear your voice.
Okay. Yeah, no problem.
Okay. Let me share the screen. I mean, you can continue. In the meantime, I will share it. I'm sorry.
No, it's okay.
Yeah, I'm sharing it right now. And you can, direct me into going into the next one. Just a second.
Okay, shall I?
Yes.
Start again. Okay. So, in the history of Islam, there are two different approaches. And if we'll look at the Muslim scholars, they keep stick with the Quranic terminology and never discuss with philosophical terminology created by Aristotle. But if a philosopher, they keep going their discussion with philosophical terminology, as I mentioned before, plant, animal, human soul classification. But of course, we're talking about two different terminology, but at the end, we're talking about the same humankind. So there should be a mutual ground between them. But interestingly, until Nursi, nobody touched that ground. But first time, Nursi introduces the concept of self through both terminology. So hopefully it gives us an idea to have better understanding. Yeah, who is Nursi is the previous the slide, yeah. Actually, I know most of you are familiar with Nursi, but I think every lecturer, guest in this program emphasize different aspects of Nursi, and maybe it's helpful, it will be for you. Nursi is a 20th century Muslim scholar. He had lived in turbulent times, late Ottoman, last decades, and the First World War, then in the first, beginning of New Turkish Republic. So the Second World War. So in 80 years, he had lived, such a turbulent life. At the end, you can see he never stopped serving or service to the Quran. That's interesting. And in his early age, if we talk about his education adventure, he never followed any proper formal education. He never been in any school or, you know, madrasa, the old name of the school in Ottoman time. But he mostly studied himself on his own. But interestingly, about when he was 15 years old, he was in the advanced level of knowledge about Islamic, actually not only Islamic literature, but also Western literature as well. Because when he was living in the city of Van, he was guest of the local governor, Tahir Pasha, and he was very curious about the science. And at the same time, he was buying all the books published in the Western world. And Nursi had a chance to see them as well, read them as well. So he was quite familiar. No, the previous one, please. He was very unique social phenomena in Turkey in Ottoman time or the Turkish Republic time. He was always active. And after his early 40s, that's an interesting information about Nursi. Most of us might have missed that point. He had just read Quran after his early 40s. But of course, until that time, especially in early ages, when he was young, he actually memorized 90 collection of books, most of them essentials, essential books in Islamic literature. Then he says he recited all those books in his mind every 3 months. And after his 40s, he just read the Quran, and also he described the universe, introduced the universe as a cosmic text. He has read the universe, the cosmic text, book of the universe, and the Quran only, with cross-referencing to each other. Then written his magnum opus, Epistle of Light, Risale-i Nur collection, dedicated to essentials of Islamic belief. The self in the Quran, as I mentioned before, 300 times almost. So 1 in 20 verse is about nafs, self, in the Quran. But of course, there are different meanings. And I just wanted to touch about the different meaning of the self here. My main target here in this slide, not to introduce the self in detail with different meanings. No. My main target is you can see how different meaning, referencing to the concept of self. Blood, life, breath, the self, the psyche, person, essence, the evil eye, the give the evil eye, precious treasure, to envy, to covet, to be sparing. There are different meanings, all referencing, addressing to the concept of self. So, plus these meanings, Quran added some new meanings to the concept of self. Then at the end, of course, we should understand deeper And we need to have a comprehensive understanding of the self. If we understand, if we want to understand the divine message, in the following, in this slide, as we mentioned before, one of two different terminologies, the Quranic terminology here, there are three different nafs or self mentioned in the Quran. The first one is al-nafs al-ammara, evil commanding soul. The second one is al-nafs al-lawwama, condemning soul. And the third one, al-nafs al-mutmainna, satisfied soul. To be honest, usually the commentators, they explain the concept of nafs al-ammara, evil commanding soul. It's a component when you feel negative, when you are engaged with the negative concepts, there is a component in your self which is leading you. Yeah. But on the other hand, al-nafs al-mutmain, satisfied soul, it seems opposite meaning of the nafs al-ammara. In other words, there is another component in yourself which is leading you to the righteous things. But I think we should ask here, is there anyone else in you, in yourself, other than you? So, you know, how possible there is someone else or another component which is not working under your command and taking you to another direction, which you are confirming or not confirming sometimes. So it's not crystal clear, no. To be honest, during the PhD and, you know, before or after, I have read several Quranic commentators, but there is no a crystal clear explanation about these components. So I think that's why Nursi is important. So I will explain in the following part of the presentation how we can relate them or discuss with Aristotle and also, you know, the similar sources produced by Western scholars or philosophers in Islamic literature. But here, another important concept, zulmu nafs. Zulmu nafs is wrongdoing to his own self. Wrongdoing to his own self. Why it is important? Because most of these 300 verses in the Quran is about zulmu nafs. So every couple of pages of the Quran, at least one time, you can come across the concept of zulmu nafs. So we need to understand what is zulmu nafs. What is wrongdoing to his own self? Then we can understand the concept of self. That gives us an idea. Yeah. Here is the other terminology which is used by the philosophers. This is created by Aristotle, Plant, vegetative soul, animal sensitive soul, human rational soul. Actually, before the my study, PhD, I was just a reader, and I was reading as a hobby. So I was quite familiar with this classification. Plant soul, animal soul, human soul, you know, always we were talking about it. But to be honest, I can easily say deep down, before deep down reading Nursi, I can easily say I didn't understand what it means, what this classification, because, you know, plant soul, animal soul, human soul. When it says plant soul, you know, we just think about the plants, trees. But in fact, the main focus here, reproduction, growth. That makes the name of this compartments plant soul, because reproduction and growth is a mutual ground for plants, animals, and humans. So that's why the name of this compartment is plant soul. Otherwise, it doesn't mean plant soul is, you know, just addressing the trees and the, you know, botanic and the trees, plants world. No. So the animal soul is mobility and sensation. So, but at this point, after, you know, very briefly talked about plants and animals, so I will ask myself or you, you know, Kuvve-i Şehaviyye, in English, lust, I think, as far as I remember now. So, Kuvve-i Şehaviyye, do you think which compartments of the soul, including the Kuvve-i Şehaviyye, the quality of lust, or, you know, the, so before the, you know, reading deep down or getting familiar with these concepts, I would easily say Kuvve-i Şehaviyye, lust, is concluded by animal soul. But in fact, no. This is included by the plant soul, because this is about reproduction. You see, you know, easy question, easy example, you know, reading as a hobby and reading and discussing the subjects deep down, how different, you get different conclusions. So, and human soul, rational soul, it's about some qualities only human being has got them, and other than human kind, not any animal, or, you know, of course, plants or any other creatures has got these qualities. So if Quran and the philosophy is talk about the same mankind, there should be a mutual ground between these two terminology. So the difference of Nursi is he discusses the concept of self through employing both these terminologies, philosophical terminology and Quranic terminology. And actually, yeah, his main difference is systematic discussion. he's not the first Muslim scholar to talk about these concepts, but his main difference is he discussed systematically compatible between these two terminology. Okay. So it's 20 to midnight, so I think we got 5-10 minutes. Is that right?
You feel free to finish the lecture, because I think these parts are also important. Otherwise, it will be left. We can continue for 5-10 minutes if you have questions. It's okay.
Mm-hmm.
To make the point is more important, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. My point was Nursi, the verse, اِهْتِنَا صِرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. Guide us to the straight path in the Surah Al-Fatiha, first surah chapter of the Quran. In the one of his books, Isharat al-Ijaz, Signs of Miraculousness of Quran, Nursi make comment on this verse, guide us to the straight path, which is related with this concept, what we're talking about. So he gives an example. Shall we go to the next slide? Then we may come back here. The next one, maybe. Yeah, this one. Mm-hmm. Okay. I try to make shortcuts. We need to describe the self, first of all. What is self? And what's the relation between self and its compartments in respect to both terminologies, Western, Aristotle classification and Quranic approach? And Nursi says the self is totality of you. And in his sixth verse, short verses, he says your body, spirit, and heart within those possessions. And very summarily, he says your outward and inward senses. This is important. Your outward and inward senses, your bodily and spiritual senses, totality of them is self. This is the self. And, there are some examples such as the eye and the tongue, intelligence, imagination, and et cetera. And if this is the description of self, the previous slides about classification of Aristotle. Yeah, that's fine. So plant soul, animal soul, human soul, as a compartments of self, the same thing. Actually, Nursi's self description is the same thing what Aristotle talks about. So there's a slight difference. That's so important. Nursi make a huge contribution to this classification, and he added another dimension or compartments of self, believing soul, al-nafs al-iman. But this is a bit tricky because this is not a separate another compartments of self. Here is such an interesting notion, the lost dimension, at the beginning of the paragraph. This expression belongs to the Christian theologian Paul Tillich, the lost dimension. There is a story about this notion, but cut the long story short. The lost dimension here is, yes, there is a plant soul, animal soul, human soul, compartments in mankind's self. However, this is only a consideration of the mankind in respect to materialistic method of science. But the mankind, if, as we said at the very beginning of the presentation, by given the very famous metaphor, mirror metaphor, is such a mirror to reflect divine, divine qualities. So how we can get this connection between this Aristotle classification and the divine qualities? So the lost dimension here is, added by Nursi, is believing soul, al-nafs al-iman. It means not another separate compartment, but the second aspect of these first three compartments. Plant soul, animal soul, human soul, there is a frame, but in this frame, there are some qualities indicates mankind and his own qualities. However, the same qualities indicates to divine concept as well. In the there's a question here, what's believing soul and nafs al-iman? In the following slides, that will be helpful to understand what we mean. Two accounts of method of science, self-referential meaning, other indicative meaning. There are new notions, very important. So actually, the title here, what is an apple? I worked as a lecturer in different universities, and I had plenty of chance to ask the same question to my students. What is an apple? Apple is such a good example to understand what we're talking about here. Then I will make a connection with the al-nafs, al-imani, how Nursi made a huge contribution to the method of science and also the concept of self. And the answer of this question in the classrooms, what's an apple? There are bullet points easily, what's an apple? One of the bullet points is texture. Okay. Another one is smell. Another one is taste. Another one is vitamin. Another one is nutrition. Another one is actually, you can add a couple of other features of an apple. It's okay. And every single time, after all bullet points, I am asking any more features, any more bullet points about apple. And the students, they look at each other and, no, that's all. Okay, perfect. And I'm taking you to the art gallery now. So if you are just like me, I'm not perfect at art. It's shame. It's a confession. But of course, art, it's such a beautiful pieces. So in every art galleries, you come across some arts, which attract you. So Imagine yourself in an art gallery and you come across an art which attracted you. What would you do? What's your first action? Believe me, almost all students in my classrooms, from different parts of the world. I'm not talking about Turkish students in Turkey only, no. We got some students from United States and from different parts of the world. Almost every student, we check the signature. Yeah. Okay, imagine the art which attracted you is an apple image. It's a beautiful apple image. So you check the signature first. But you know, I ask you what's an apple. You gave me bullet points, but never talking about its creator. Okay, I'm offering you a comparison between an apple image and real apple, which is perfect. It's a silly question. There is no comparison. Of course, a real apple is perfect. So we can, if we give hand in hand all humanity, we can create a Ferrari, a Lamborghini, or space shuttle. But we can't create an apple. No. But still, you know, you didn't talk about its artist. You just given me some features or, you know, qualities about Apple. You know why? Because of the frame of the materialistic science. It gives you a frame, so it doesn't give you a chance to ask more questions or, you know, yeah. So in this example, there are two different terms, created by Nursi. Self-referential meaning. Self-referential meaning, mana ismi, means to consider the things through materialistic method of science. This is mana ismi. This is self-referential meaning. Just like to describe apple with the bullet points indicates just an apple, but nothing other than that. Other indicative meaning, manaya harfi, is the signature, indicating the signature, indicating to artist. You know what? The very interesting point here that we need to emphasize. You know, I talked about the presentation. Now, here is science, here is religion. As you see, they are separate. They're, you know, incompatible. And Nursi talks about a new presentation. And he changed the presentation, and there is a circle here, self-referential meaning, or the concept of materialistic understanding of the universe, investigating things through the materialistic aspect. He put it in the center and he draws another circle around it and name as other indicative meaning. So the most important thing here, Nursi, with this new presentation, two circles within each other working together. So the second and big circle, other indicative meaning, all information is produced from the small circle that inside. Just like the example, apple example. You get the conclusion you jump out, jump to the creative. How? Because there is an art, but art, not only art, but also actually texture is such a miraculous, you know, miraculousness of engineering. The taste, you know, you can classify the entire taste in the universe on a scale. You can put them in order. So the entire universe, the old tastes in the universe, indicates one creator who knows all the taste, all the knowledge, and then he can create the all tastes. Or the same thing applicable to the concept of smell, or the vitamin, or you can increase the bullet points, but the apple is not just a nutrition to humankind. There are qualities, and these qualities can only be created by a person who got absolute knowledge and the absolute power to create them, to realize them. We will get the questions at the end, but usually, you know, when I was teaching this course in the classroom, that would be, you know, nice if I had a chance to get some questions, because, you know, this is very crucial point here now about the concept of self, because these two new notions, self-referential meaning and other indicative meaning, is quite new and gives another perspective angle. So we are going to jump to the concept of self after this small discussion. Any question, Dr. Çolak, right now, or?
The point that you have made is, you know, between the self-referential meaning and also the other indicative meaning. These are the concepts. Are these the concepts only Nursi talks about? And, you know, the concepts give us an idea about what to think and how to think about them. So when we consider everything from the philosophical point of view and think everything is within the concept of self-referential meaning, then we only think of within the boundaries of the matter, the feature, the texture, the taste, you know, only the physical features, right? So, but if we talk about an other indicative meaning, and then it creates a huge potential for us to be able to get to know about the creator. Who is the creator? And how do I get to know about it? We had this discussion earlier with Dr. Hakan Gök about atheism. So that was about whether or not God exists. But in this point, we have a huge possibility of getting to know the creator based on the created world around us. So this is very exciting, because, you know, I have never heard of anyone else talking about this other than Nursi. So I wanted to ask you, if this is specific to Nursi, have you come across with anyone else who is talking about these concepts, or is this very unique to Nursi?
Definitely very unique to Nursi. We talked about his reading Quran only after his, you know, early 40s. That is a connection with it, because, you know, these two different notions or different approaches to the things in the universe. You know, Quran, when Quran talks about the universe, always, you know, make a connection how it indicates to divine concept. You know, after 40 years, and he passed away about, you know, 87 years old. It means, you know, more than 40 years he had read only Quran. So easily make a distinction between, you know, Quranic approach to the universe and the other books. So I think this is a conclusion of this, his real, genuine experience, life experience. So yeah, definitely unique to Nursi. And about method of science, I believe in the following years, even, you know, for a while, I know I'm familiar with last 20, 30 years, most of the scientists are not happy with the, you know, frame of the materialistic method of science, because, you know, can you imagine a method which cannot explain every data? No. So you cannot select the data. Okay, I can explain this one and can't explain that one. No, if it's a method of science, if it's a method, you can explain everything, every data. So you cannot have a chance to, you know, select or, you know, no. So in the following years, hopefully, the new approach, you know, the problem before religion, when some people claim there's an incompatibility between religion and science, because in that time, that time religion was using different language, or at least was not using the any language close to science, no. So that's why some scientists or some people claimed there's the possible incompatibility. But Nursi, as we see very briefly in the Apple example, talks about, use the same language, same terminology, and yeah, Apple, yes, through method of science, materialistic method of science, indicates itself there are some bullet points, but at the same time, these bullet points, the same bullet points, indicates to its creator, because Apple cannot be created by anyone who doesn't have all information about Apple and who hasn't got, you know, absolute power. No. If there is an Apple, okay. So you don't need to see the creator of the Apple, because you see the Apple. Yeah. And the same approach applicable to the concept of self and the lost dimension, as Paul Tillich you know, called this other indicative meaning. Other indicative dimension is the lost dimension. You know, the XY coordinate in analytical geometry. Mm-hmm. So, you know, X coordinate horizontal. So every single point on the X coordinates, there should be a counterpart on the Y coordinate. Materialistic method of science claim we just interested in the X coordinate, but doesn't consider the Y. This approach gives us a chance to interpret every single data in our daily lives to jump to divine concept. So that's interesting, yeah.
For some reason, the screen share stopped.
It's okay.
Yeah. We have it here again.
Okay. Let's. Shall we go to the next one?
I think you talked about this one. Are you gonna?
Just you know. Very briefly, if you need to make a summary about this slide, just like the apple example, nafs is the apple here. And there are some bullet points about the self, nafs, which are the compartments of self as classified by Aristotle, plant soul, animal soul, and human soul with their tools, inward and outward senses. There are all bullet points. Yes, there are three compartments. In the frame of materialistic method of science, they are all indicating to humankind. But with Nursi's new approach, other indicative meaning, he adds another dimension. It's not another compartment, no, another dimension. And this dimension gives us a chance to read the first three compartments to understand divine concept. So every single bullet point in the plant soul, animal soul, and human soul, they are indicating to divine concept. If we need to give an example, you know, very easy one, and I think it's easy to understand and to think about the concept of sight, eye. Allah gives us, created eye, the concept, you know, the eye. The question is here, Nursi asks in the sixth word, actually this question is made by my own words, not in his words. It is possible to create an eye without having every single information, knowledge, detail about the concept of sight. No, you can never create an eye if you haven't got the entire details and information and knowledge about the concept of sight. So this is the first step. The second step, if there is an eye, so you don't need to see the creator of the eye, because you know, you got the eye in your hand. Just like apple example, is it possible to create an apple without having the entire information, knowledge, detail about an apple? No, you can never create an apple if you haven't got the entire knowledge, the absolute knowledge. Actually, knowledge is not the only tool or source to create an apple, because you also need an absolute power to create, to realize your knowledge, your all the information, details about an apple. So about human self, mankind self, one of the example, the concept of sight. Yeah, God created an eye. So if there is an eye, you don't need to see the creator, because his own art, work, because there is no possibility to create an eye without having absolute knowledge and absolute power. Okay. Again, the screen share, I think. And that's some reason. Okay. So we need to make this, make a point before ending this, you know, presentation about the self, because, okay, we talked enough about the Aristotle classification. We are quite familiar with the plant, animal, human, soul compartments. But how about the Quranic terminology? Evil commanding soul and nafs al-ammara and nafs al-mutmainna, tranquil soul. So in the same short word, in the sixth word, after the description of self, Nursi says, actually, I wish, you know, we had some time to give every single example of him in the in his words, you know, sixth word. But at least I can say that he has chosen three examples from three different compartments of self. One example from plant soul, kuvve-i şehaviye, lust. Actually, lust is negative engagement, by the way. Another example is actually in the sixth word, he has given one example from each compartments, three examples. The first example is mind from human soul. The second one is I from animal soul. And the third one is the quality of taste, tongue, from plant soul, which is about, you know, related with growth concept. So, and Nursi says, you can employ these qualities, you can employ them into two different accounts. As we discussed before, as we introduced before, self-referential meaning or other indicator meaning. What does it mean? You can employ your the qualities in your self, plant soul, animal soul, human soul, every single quality in each compartments of your self, soul, into two different accounts. One account is the right one to understand divine concept, divinity. How? The first example is mind from human soul. Actually, mind is such a quality that interprets the data in the produced by all the other tools, inward and outward senses, then get the abstract conclusion. I mean, you can see through your eyes, but eyes are windows. The differentiator is your mind. Interpreter is your mind. Eye is just a window. And the same thing applicable to ears, taste, and etc. Or all your outward and inward senses. But the main function of the mind is to get abstract conclusions. So there are three examples just came to my mind. And a tree feeds its fruits. An animal feeds, you know, a mother animal, or, you know, female, feed her baby, and a human mother, mom, feed her baby. There are three different creatures, but the same reflection, the compassion, şefkat, şefkat, compassion. The mind read the different examples, three different examples as we mentioned, and to get the and jump to the conclusion, abstract conclusion that of, okay, there are three different mirrors, but the same reflection. Just one easy example just came to my mind now. So compassion, there are two options. This compassion belongs to these different creatures, or there is the one, God, who has absolute compassion, and its reflection on different mirrors. Nursi gives another metaphor, bubbles on the river. In a sunny day, you can see a reflection of the sun on the bubbles. There are two options. Every single bubble has got a sun in it or on it. Or there is only one sun in the sky, but all the or little or small suns on the bubbles, just a reflection. After a while, when the bubbles get into the tunnel, the connection, you know, when they lose their connection with the sunlight, bubbles there, but sun is not on them or every single bubble. So every single creature in the universe, we live in a certain time, we reflect something on us, but the reflection has, you know, just disappears after the life ended. So here the metaphor bubbles on the river indicates what we're talking about, you know, the reflection of the compassion on different creatures and its connection with the God. Yeah. Okay. So we can increase the examples. So every single quality in our self indicates ultimately divine qualities. Yeah, we can go to the next one, the last one. Here is, again, the same statement at the beginning of the presentation, the key to the word. It's okay, we talked about it. But the first one, while being apparently open, the doors of the universe are in fact closed. It's interesting. It's just about the last part of the presentation, what we talk about the previous slide. So, you know, the bubbles, the reflections of the sun on the bubbles. Every single data we come across in the universe should ultimately take us to the divine concept. If they don't introduce us the divine concept, then this statement just being realized, or, you know, the universe, the doors of the universe just look like open, because you can investigate the universe. Today we talk about nanotechnology, you know, we were talking about atoms 50 years ago or maybe more, but now we are talking about quarks. So the doors of the universe look open, but in fact closed. Why it's closed? Because every single data in the universe should take us to the divine concept, should introduce divinity. If not, it means that the universe are in fact close to us. Because, you know, very famous narration from the Prophet Muhammad, Allah says, you know, I created the universe, the things, to be known. So if the universe doesn't introduce, or every single thing, creature in the universe, does not introduce the divine concept, so it means the door of the universe are closed to us, because ultimately it's related with divine concept. Yeah. Okay, I think.
Thank you so much, Dr. Kuru. This is amazing. And we have a few questions. And this was a very hard topic, one of the most difficult topics of Risale. And I think you have made an excellent job of diving into the depth of the subject and, you know, making it so clear, crystal clear, as you said, so we could understand. And there is a few questions. I mean, there is a question on the YouTube, and there is also a question that Yonara wants to ask, and I would like to give her the, you know, priority since she's here, and then I will ask the question that comes us from YouTube. Please, Yonara, you can ask your question now.
Thank you so much, Dr. Mekur. Thank you so much for the wonderful lecture that you just gave us tonight. So I have one question, but it's divided in two questions. So the first part is, you know, what are some works that, you know, I can read on the NEFs? So where I can learn more about the different types of NEFs. And then the second part would be, so by having a better understanding of the concept and types of NEFs, would that make it easy for one to overcome their NEFs?
The connection was not perfect. I couldn't understand your question. Would you?
Okay. The first one. What I was wondering is, what are some works that I can read on the NEFs where I can learn more about the different types of NEFs? And the second one. What I would like to know, and there might be someone else out there that would have the same, you know, question. It's by having a better understanding of the concept and types of NEFs, would that make it easier for one to overcome their NEFs?
Yeah. I would like to say, it's not difficult, but, you know, if you're familiar with the Nursian approach to the concepts, you know, mainly, you know, the other indicative meaning, self-referential meaning, then it's easy to understand different types of nafs, self, their characteristics, and how they work within each other or related with each other. But the negative thing today, Nursian approach is not common. Yeah, many people, they don't know anything about Nursi, or, you know, day by day people are getting familiar, but at the moment there are not so many sources. To be honest, you know, at the same time, I have, you know, I would like to say, in throughout the 15th century, you know, the Sufi approaches are, you know, people are familiar with the Sufi approaches, and there are so many books and articles, and very famous scholars like, you know, Seyyid Hüseyin Nasır, William Chittick, the cornerstones scholar in Western world, they focused on the classical Sufism. So it means classical approach to the self. The problem is there is a sort of contradiction between Nursi'nin approach and the classical approach. Because, you know, in the classical approach, their understanding of the different types of self in Quran, okay, nafsul emmare is very basic stage of the self. Then, you know, you can put one more step than call as nafsul lawwama, self-criticizing soul. Then you can go to nafsul mutmainna. But Nursi, his interpretation is completely different, because he says there is a self, just like explained by Aristotle, and with its tools, outward and inward senses, and you can employ them into two different categories. If you employ them to understand divine concept, you can get the nafsul mutmainne, tranquil soul. But if you employ them for anything other than divine concept, you can go to evil commanding soul. As you see, it's completely different approach. But, you know, it's at the same time, it's simple, understandable, doable, and it's, to be honest, you know, to see his discussions through both philosophical terminology and the Quranic terminology, it gives you confidence to see, okay, I'm on the right path. Nursi talks about the things, you know, which is right, because it's consistent with science, philosophy. It gives you extra confidence. But again, you know, the other side, 15th century Muslim scholars, Western Muslim scholars, their all books and articles focused on classical Sufism. So I don't know what to say.
Thank you so much. And I wish we had time, more time, you know, to discuss. There is so many aspects of this issue that we can talk about. And I want to get the question from the YouTube, and then I may ask one question if we still have time. The question that came from YouTube is written by an account which is called Stimulated Stats. And it goes like this. Does the nafs belong only to humans and animals? Does it also exist in plants or angels?
Okay, that's an interesting question. All the questions are amazing. Yonara's question also. I wish, honestly, you know, we had plenty of time to discuss about this, you know, questions and their answers. Actually, self, the crucial point of the question is, you know, if we change the question slightly, what's the difference between angel and humankind? Yeah. Humankind has body and soul or spirit. You know, or in nursing terminology, what we briefly talked, outward and inward senses, bodily and spiritual senses. Humankind, ourself, we got bodily senses and spiritual senses. But angels, they don't have body. So, what, you know, what would we say? What should we say? About animals or plants, they got something, you know, because three compartments of self, plant, animal soul has got plant soul as well. But at the end, what's the conclusion? And what we where we are going to go, where or what is the
benefit? Is that what
you benefit mean? Or conclusion? But I think the first answer or first approach, you know, when we slightly change the question, that was the center of the discussion, that should be center. So there's a difference between angel and mankind. As we said before, emphasize the difference. But I would like to say something more, which is very important. Because of mankind has got bodily senses and spiritual senses, it gives him or her a chance to experience his knowledge. Like, you know, very simple, basic, but it gives an idea. You know, you can see a jar of honey, but unless having taste, you can never know what it is. Bodily senses gives you a chance to get a real experience. Angels doesn't have that chance. So that's why mankind has a great potentiality to go forward. Like, you know, the Miraj, ascending of the Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. At certain point, you know, one of the biggest angels, Gabriel, he says, okay, I stop here. I cannot go beyond this point. So I think this the concept is related with what we're talking about.
Thank you. Thank you so much. It's a very deep subject, and I wish we had, you know, more time. And also, when you started, you know, the lecture, you made a point that that you are not going to look at this whole topic from the perspective of ego, but you will present everything from the perspective of nafs and self. So I now understand. It just, you know, give us a huge realm, you know, to move forward, you know, with this information that we have learned, with this knowledge that we have received right now. Now it is a guiding principle for our lives when we combine, especially with your relating it with the sixth word, the taste and the eye and the mind, you know, these three categories, I think, is very crucial in thinking about the self because, you know, we experience the world with our eyes, with our taste. You know, we see something, we taste it, and we think about it. You know, we use our mind to reason as well. So I think this is very crucial. I have never, heard this before. So for me, it's revolutionary. It opens up a new understanding in the area of the concept of self. And I think we need another session to discuss the concept of ego and ene, the self right now. And I don't know if we can discuss it later, but thank you so much. This is very eye-opening, very much for me, it's revolutionary to make those connections and to, connect the dots so the big picture is out there and we can implement it in our lives. And it is so now the concept of self is normally a very difficult subject, but you made it so relevant to us. Now that, every time, just like the apple example that we have learned from you today, and with the Aristotelian understanding of those three categories and how it corresponds to, our understanding of self, right now everything is interconnected. We see the whole, meaning of the concept of self and how it relates to us in our everyday life. So one way, if we don't know this concept, we are cut off in this material world and we don't receive any information about the creator. We don't receive any knowledge. We are just stuck in this material horizontal world. But if we can see it from this perspective where you very fancily, very nicely, very clearly made those connections between philosophical and Quranic approach through Nursi, now everything is related. Everything makes sense, and that every day in our everyday life, when we drink a glass of water, when we wash the trees, the beauties around us, now we can use all these formulas that you have taught us today and make a connection to the creator, find a way to the creator by using this concept of self. So I'm very excited. I want to write about this right now so I don't forget. And luckily we have this recorded, and when people ask us, we can refer them to this discussion. And, apparently the subject is very abstract and very difficult, and it took us a longer time to be able to, put everything together. But I think it is a great job that you have done to make such a difficult subject, such an abstract subject, so close, so relatable, so, easy to understand, so crystal clear, so we can make sense with it in our lives. Thank you so much, Dr. Ömer Kuru. It was a pleasure. I mean, it's been 1 hour and 40 minutes. I didn't realize how it passed. I enjoyed every minute of it. Thank you so much. And I wish we have another session with you in the future. And Yonara, is there anything you would like to say?
I just wanted to thank you, Zuleyha, and thank you, Dr. Ömer Kuru, for the opportunity. And I think, like me, a lot of people tonight are feeling more enlightened and have a better understanding of the nafs. So thank you so much. I really appreciate
it. It was my pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome. I just wanted to couple of things very briefly. Actually, there are some more details in Isharatul Ijaz and 23rd word about the nafs, and the compartments. Always, he discusses systematically. In the short words, like the sixth one, Nursi used a language which is understandable to 7 to 70. Mm-hmm. So sometimes, people have a misconception, because of the language. However, there are so deep concepts he talks about. When you look at the entire Risale, Epistle of Light, through this angle, you can get the connections and you see how he discussed systematically. So, And I don't know if we have a chance to talk about ANA, but ANA is one of the tools in human soul. And he has two aspects. It has two aspects. One aspect is ego, self-referential meaning, but the other aspect, other indicative meaning, which introduces the concept of divinity again. Another important tool in contemporary Sufism, based on, to be honest. So that would be nice. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I feel so blessed and so excited. And I don't think I will be able to sleep tonight thinking about these concepts now, these connections. Thank you so much. We look forward to having you again next time. This was a very difficult subject, but it is so clear now. And it will be recorded and will be available in YouTube. So we will, invite, people to think about it, listen to it. So thank you so much, Dr. Kuru.
You're welcome. Thank you very much.
We look forward to having you next time. Thank you.
Me too. Thank you very much to you and Yonara and the other audience in YouTube. Thank you.
Thank you so much for having me.
You're welcome.
Thank you. It was a pleasure. Have a wonderful evening.
You too. Bye-bye.